So my name is Ranjit, and my co-authors are Aditya Nigam, Arnab Hafsar, Sudhir K. Pathak, Walter, and Atish K. My paper title is Multi-Shell Diffusion MRI Reconstruction via Residual Learning Utilizing Encoded Decoded Network with Attention. So let us begin with the MRI, that is magnetic resonance imaging. So research in brain image analysis, especially from clinical perspective, is largely based on magnetic resonance imaging. So this is the typical diagram for MRI scanning. So if you see here we have a 3 Tesla MRI scanner, and patient is inside the scanner. So, and the signals are coming from this scanner. And then we have, this is K-space. So in K-space, we have phase encoding and frequency encoding. And then finally, we are applying inverse Fourier transform, and we are getting the output image. So in MRI scanning, we have two types of imaging. One is T1 imaging, and second one is T2 imaging. T1 imaging is due to a longitudinal magnetization phase, and T2 imaging is due to a transversal magnetization phase. Now come to the diffusion MRI. So this is nothing but this weighted T2 imaging. Here we have several sampling techniques. The first one is diffusion tensor imaging. It has some limitation that it assumes at each voxel only one fiber direction. But in real scenario, we have more than one fiber direction at each voxel. So several new techniques came for resolving this issue. So we have this diffusion spectrum imaging, and then we have a high angular resolution diffusion imaging, HARDI. So we have single cell HARDI. So in single cell HARDI, we have only one B values, but at particular B values, we have several directions. But in multi-cell HARDI, we have several B values. Okay. Now, this is the typical diagram for showing the gradient strength and gradient direction and the acquisition technique and diffusion time. So in this direction, the gradient strength has been increased. So we are going from 0 to 1000, 2000, 3000 in diffusion time. In this direction, this is diffusion time will be increased. And in this direction, we are changing the gradient direction. And in this direction, we are moving from diffusion tensor imaging to the HARDI. In diffusion tensor, we are only less number of volumes, but if you go for HARDI, we have a more number of volumes. Now this is the diagram for showing the relationship between Q space and K space. So Q space is, these are Q space. Okay, so every point lies in Q space. So now this is the Q space, and in this Q space, each point represents one gradient direction, and every, each volume is corresponding to every gradient direction. So here each direction represents one volume in image space. And now this volume has been built from several K space matrices. So in K space, we have every 2D matrix containing frequency and phase information of a particular slice. So diffusion MRI, DMRI, is one of the most popular non-invasive MRI techniques for study of brain and white matter fibers, which helps to characterize the different mental disease and can also help in surgical planning. So this is the diagram of, this is the brain imaging at different B values. So we can see B equal to 0, 1000, 2000, 3000 if you are moving from here in this direction. So where contrast will be increased, and it's at the same time the fine tissue information we can get. So this is the motivation. So motivation is if you have multi-cell diffusion MRI, then multi-cell diffusion MRI provides volume fraction for different types of tissue, hence more accurate fiber ODF estimation than single-cell diffusion MRI. So if you have multi-cell MRI, so we have this multi-tissue constant spherical deconvolution, so it will give us a fiber-oriented distribution function. And then if you do the tractography on this, so we'll get these type of fibers. And there are several applications of this in traumatic brain injury to identify the broken brain connection, and in several other applications. Now the problem with this multi-cell diffusion MRI is that it needs more scanning time. And if it needs more scanning time, a patient cannot tolerate that amount of time inside the machine. And hence it is not very suitable in clinical setting. Now, by utilizing only single cell, how we can get the accurate fiber-oriented distribution function? So this is the approach that we can do. So what we'll do, just we'll take the single cell HARDI, and we'll convert this single cell HARDI into a spherical harmonic coefficient, and then we map this spherical harmonic coefficient at 3000 to 2000 and 3000 by this proposed reconstruction module. So here our contribution is here. Okay, and then finally what we'll do, just we'll convert this spherical harmonics into the Hardy volumes, and finally we'll apply this multi-tissue constant spherical deconvolution and we'll get the accurate fiber ODF estimation. So these things I already have told. Now this the problem statement is that we propose a novel encoder decoder architecture MSR net with a feature network and attention network to transform spherical harmonics SS coefficient of volume at 3000 to those at 2000. Each input and output volumes have the shape this 174 into 145 into 145 into 45. This is number of slices. This is the spatial that height and width, and then we have coefficient per boxer. These are some related work, but this work, augmentation of single cell diffusion MRI data to predict multi-cell using DENN, this is very related to our work. So we'll see in next slide. So the authors have utilized fully connected based deep neural network to learn transformation between three types of cell, 1000, 2000, 3000 for voxel level transformation. They have done the experiment in a spherical harmonic space by transforming one coefficient space to another and achieve the promising results. However, this approach considers a limited amount of white matter voxels which does not demonstrate its generalizability. Also, as transformation at each voxel is learned independently, the approach does not consider a spatial relationship among voxels. Now, this is our proposed network, proposed architecture. So here we have input, encoder, bottleneck, decoder, and output. So input. So input shape is 145 into 145 into 45. So this is the height, width, and number of coefficient values at each voxel. So we are doing training slice by slice. So each slice is of size this 145 into 145 into 45. Then we have encoder path. So encoder path we have consists of multi blocks where each block containing two convolution layers with a layer having size filter size 3x3, and between every two blocks there is a pooling layer which reduces the size of image by 2 and helps to capture the more aggregated features. And then we have I will discuss this thing in upcoming slides. Then first I will discuss the decoder path. So this decoder path is just opposite to encoder. So here, instead of pooling, we have upsampling, and then we have convolution, and we are going from 128 to 64, just opposite to this encoder part. And then we have convolution layer in each block. And here also we have a skip connection, so that the spatial information will be coming from the upper encoder part. And finally, we have output layer. So here we have residual connection. So base information is coming from here, and then residual information is coming from here, and then finally we are getting this output. Now the feature module. So feature module has this module helps to see the image at different receptive fields. So here do 2 3x3 filters equivalent to 1 5x5 filter, and this is 3x3, so we are seeing the image by 1 5x5 filter and then 1 3x3 filter, and finally we are concatenating this thing and we are applying convolution, and then we are getting this SW. So here we are getting the multi-scale multi-level features, and finally we are adding this thing with input here SWC with and apply convolution, and then finally we are getting this WC and we are adding this. So this is sort of base information that we are passing from here, and this is so here this is residual learning. Then talk about attention module. So in attention module, we have the attention module learns how much emphasis should be given to the each channel. This also helps in faster convergence. So here we have several things. So we have global pooling. So the task of global pooling layer is to generate descriptor channel by aggregating features map along their spatial dimension. And after that, we have two fully connected layer network have been flagged along with sigmoid nonlinear function. Which takes the embedding as an input and creates a set of modulation weight per channel working as a self-gating mechanism. Now come to the training part. So to train the network, we have utilized standard L2 loss and content loss along with various hyperparameters. Content loss is this loss quantifies the difference between the content of two slices by measuring the distance between two slices in the feature space of the encoder and gives a better chance of improving the fine details of predicted slice. I predict. We have provided the predicted slice IPRED and corresponding ground truth slice IGT to E network trend for K epoch initially, and have taken the output feature map EPRED, E of IPRED and E of IGT respectively. The shape of both E of IPREDIC and E of IGT are 18 into 18 into 160. Hence, the content loss can be defined as this. So we have this is the depth from 1 to 160. Then this is special thing, that is I plus 1 to 18, J equal to 1 to 18. And so then we are subtracting pixel by pixel, and then we're squaring this. So this is a mean square error, but in between ground truth and predicted, but in encoder space. Now this is data specific. So we have randomly selected data of 18 subjects from a CP dataset, and they belong to age between 22 and 35. In order to checking the generalization of our network, we divided our data into three folds for training and testing partition. In each fold, we randomly choose 10 subjects for training and remaining 8 for testing. So training is performed at slice level, where for each subject we have 174 slices. Hence, total number of slices for training equal to 1,740 and testing 81,392. The final performance parameters are reported as a mean over all folds. Now for each subject, the shape of the coefficient volume is 174 into 145 into 145 into 45. So this is slice number of slices, spatial thing, and a coefficient per voxel. Now this is the result. So if you see the result, so this is the ground truth for corpus callosum, and this is predicted for corpus callosum. So and in SS space. So we can see that these two images are very, very similar. Even in this case, for cortico-spinal tract also, if you see, these two images are very, very similar. And similarly for patient two also. If you see at voxel level, so this is the ground truth and this is the predicted one. So ground truth is slightly smoother than predicted, but if you see the directions of both have the same direction. So the fiber direction is coming from here in this case, and in this case also from here. So and in similar way for cortical spinal tract also. So this is slightly more smoother than this predicted one, and in similar way for patient 2 also. If you see the diffusion ODF, so this is the ground truth diffusion ODF and this is predicted diffusion. So both are very, very similar, but here this is the noise in this ground truth, but in predicted we don't have noise. So this, it means our network is giving even our network is removing the noise in the case of this ODF. So this is the ground truth ODF voxel and this is predicted. So both are very, very similar. Even they are same. So now come to the quantitative analysis. So we have two types of performance parameter. One is average absolute difference. That is, so we have done this thing. So this is, we have 8 testing subjects. So we are going for N1 to 8, S1 to 2, so we have this number of slices and this is a special thing, then coefficient, and then we are subtracting this thing. Then we have relative error. So relative error, so this is a percentage relative error. So here this is similar to this one, but we are just one extra thing, that is IGT, and we are dividing this thing by this IGT. So this is relative error with respect to ground truth. Now these are this is the result. So if you see, we have observed results at 3 levels, that is volume, slice and voxel. So at volume level we have everything in 10 to power minus 3, even at slice level also and voxel level also. But this relative error we are getting higher. But if you see the qualitative things, then there we have very, very similar results. And this is the just showing the volume wise for each subject, we are showing the average absolute difference. So here mean is very, very less, and even variance is also very, very less. And in this case also we have our mean and variance are very, very less, and the voxel also we have very less. Now we have compared our approach with this approach. So in this case, if you see that we are getting 1.59%, which is far better than this DNF. Finally, the conclusion part is that we propose an approach to transform a spherical harmonic coefficient in diffusion MRI from 1000 to 2000 via an encoder-decoder structure with attention and feature module and using content loss. We show via various quantitative results and visualization that our proposed network yields promising results. Now the future work. So in the future, we plan to consider its effectiveness for the tractograph. Thank you.